Good afternoon, everyone. It's about 1 minute to two. We're going to get started. So we're now on item 24B. This is the Carson City Freeway update. And so everybody knows we'll be taking the Board of Supervisors non-action items after item 26B today before concluding public comment. So are we ready to go? Mr. Schultz, are you doing it? Or who's Mr. Pittenger? Okay, Mr. Pittenger, let's hear about the agreements or
okay. NDOT. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Patrick Pittenger, Transportation Manager, Carson City Public Works Department. We thought it appropriate to come before you today while we primarily deal with the Regional Transportation Commission of Carson City on transportation matters. We realize that the freeway is the biggest project going in town, over $40 million for the current phase, and folks can see a lot of work that's going on out there right now. The big pile of dirt on the south end is finally starting to disappear. You can see the sound walls going up north of Coons Lane on the west side of the road, and rocks actually going up on the slopes already. We're still looking at early 17 opening, which is what NDOT is sticking with. We appreciate that. And also there have been a few questions about a pending agreement amendment to the agreement that we're looking at. So we're here before you today to just give you an update on where we stand, and as Darren was pointing out to me, this, you know, a lot of what we're going to show you today is frankly information we've provided already to this board and of course to the RTC as well, but we're happy to review. This is just a brief overview before I go into a little bit more detail. It's a timeline. You can see the years across the middle there from 1997 out to 2017 and beyond. On the top, we have the agreement and the various amendments, and below, we have the various phases. So going across the top first, the original agreement was executed in 1997, Amendment 1 in 2004, Amendment 2 in 2007, Amendment 3 in 2009, and finally Amendment 4, which is under development right now, is expected to be adopted in 2016. That's still in draft at this time. And I want to point out, I'll reiterate that all of these actions have come before this Board of Supervisors for approval in the past, and Amendment 4 that is forthcoming will do so as well. The lower portion there, the list of different phases, we didn't want to list when they all started and ended. We realized that some of these spanned multiple years, of course, but phase 1A and B opened to traffic 2006 at Highway 50. 2009, phase 2A opened to Fairview Drive. That's the portion of the road that's still open today. But NDOT has made significant progress since then in multiple phases. Phase 2B was divided into four subphases. Phase 2B-1 constructed the bridges at Kuntz and Clearview, as well as storm drainage improvements. 2B-2 constructed the bridge at Snyder, also with some very significant storm drainage improvements, including detention basins. And both of those being completed has made 2B 3 move along much faster because there weren't bridges to build, for example. 2B-3 is the one that's underway now. Significant earthwork, sound walls are going up now, and it'll open to Spooner in 2017. And without a specific date, future date to be determined is phase 2B-4, which is the actual interchange, a planned grade separated full freeway interchange. That is still planned, but it is not programmed, scheduled, or budgeted at this time. And I'll move on to the next one, and I'm going to go into a little more detail. I'd say I did, but I probably talked too much on the previous slide. This is just a recap of each of the phases. Originally envisioned to be phase 1 and 2. It's gone from two original phases to a total of seven phases. And we know that obviously it's taken a while to do. One piece of information that I didn't just cover was that the last line there, the estimated cost of that interchange that is not being constructed at this time is $20 to $25 million, and indeed they're going to be constructing an at-grade intersection, a traffic signal. It will, however, have improvements over a regular intersection. For example, cars northbound on 395 will have a ramp to get right onto the freeway, and there will be a triple left from the freeway terminus to go south towards Douglas County. And there will be a free right turn if you're heading southbound to go up to Lake Tahoe, for example. And that intersection will be feeling the pain of traffic control this summer. They're still working on the final plans, but that is going to be a big undertaking as part of the current project. The agreements, I won't read all the words on here, just the basics are that the original agreement was from 1997. It basically covered the first phase of the freeway construction, including a financial payments over time by the city to the state through a 5-cent fuel tax. Amendment 1, which was done in 2004, accomplished several tasks and basically addressed the second phase of construction. But there were some key points there that that amendment allowed for the suspension of payments to allow the city to use those funds to improve Fairview Drive, because as we all know, the freeway has been terminating at Fairview Drive for some time now and dealing with increased traffic. The city agreed for additional funding for phase two, but only through through 3 cents of the 5 cent fuel tax. And amendment one is also where the city agreed to accept South Carson Street in the future. So as we'll discuss in a little while, the transfer of Carson Street to the city was approved back in 2004. Also in 2004, November 10th, was when the Board of Supervisors removed the sunset on the 5 cent fuel tax. So the indication at that time was that the 5 cent fuel tax would continue, and the intent was that 3 cents of that would go to pay for the second phase of the freeway. Amendment 2 was adopted December of 2007. It deferred the 3 cent payment until July 1st, 2009 for Fairview Drive. And this is the first portion where additional roads in the city were agreed to be taken by the city from the state in lieu of the remaining payments for phase one, which had not yet been completed at that time. And that totaled a $4.8 million relief of our debt to them. And then the final amendment that has been approved was Amendment 3 in 2009. It once again provided for the transfer of additional roads from the DOT, from the state to the city, in exchange for a further reduction of the debt that was owed and a deferral of the 3 cent payment previously agreed upon until after the completion of the freeway. So there is a remaining balance.
Can we ask questions as we go?
Yes, go ahead.
The $7.8 million in reduction for Carson Street, is that from Williams to Fifth Street?
No, that was actually for a longer portion. I have it tabbed in here. Just one moment. Yeah, it was actually for additional $5 million of the reduction was related to the relieving NDOT from the requirement to do the rehabilitation. I believe it was actually for a much longer stretch of Carson Street. Here it is. I believe it was from Arrowhead all the way south. Here we go. Yes, it was in lieu of NDOT's performance of pavement servicing, which was to be undertaken pursuant to the agreement, from Arrowhead Drive to Fairview.
Which incorporated downtown Carson Street,
that
correct?
Is correct, but it was
a larger
area.
Can you know the distance from Arrowhead to Fairview? If that's the, how much money was reimbursed back for that stretch?
$5 million was the amount of credit that the city received in lieu of the pavement treatment that NDOT would have done.
From Arrowhead to Fairway, correct?
Fairview, yes.
And then from Fairway to the interchange is another $5 million. Is that correct?
We're going to get there, but it, yes, it's approximately $5 million that is being discussed as part of a future potential agreement.
So is that the same distance and mileage?
I don't believe so, but I don't have the measurement off the top of my head.
Okay.
Not hard to measure. Okay. Okay, so moving on to what Supervisor Shirk referred to. So the freeway agreement and the amendments did not, you know, fully anticipate exactly how NDOT ended up phasing the freeway. Frankly, until just before they started phase 2B-3, which is currently under construction, they actually had plans to not open it until they did phase 4. This is obviously a good benefit of the way they're phasing it, so it opens to traffic, but that didn't take into account. So, for example, the freeway is going to open to traffic next year, but the question was, what is the disposition of that $7.1 million and the transfer of the street? We also noted here that in the 8-cent sales tax that was implemented in 2014, was implemented for corridor improvements that, as has been discussed at length at these meetings and otherwise, include not just downtown Carson Street, but also Carson Street to the north, to the south, William Street to the east. When we did the development of the capital plan for those corridors, it did estimate that approximately $5 million would be transferred from the state to the city in lieu of pavement improvements there to allow to facilitate the development of those corridors. So NDOT is nearing completion of a draft amendment. We have met with them, discussed it with them, and I put down expected terms. We haven't seen it in writing yet, but this is what we expect to see when we receive it from the Nevada Department of Transportation. The South Carson Street transfer to the city, as previously agreed upon, will occur after 2B-3 is open. So when the freeway opens to traffic, after the contractor's closed out, the road will be transferred to the city. NDOT would perform minor maintenance activities along South Carson Street. I can tell you that I talked to the deputy director yesterday, and he confirmed that they were still, not only were they going down that path, the project is actually out to bid right now. It includes both some limited sidewalk work, some patching, and a micro paving operation there. So NDOT is carrying through on what they've intended to do, which is to pursue a contract to extend the life of that pavement. Additionally, NDOT would provide a $5 million payment to Carson City in lieu of the resurfacing project that they had originally planned. And in addition to that minor maintenance that I just discussed, the funds, when transferred, could only be used on South Carson Street for their intended purposes. And they are expected to ask that the project that we undertake begin by 2019. That is directly related to the analysis by NDOT engineers and their materials folks regarding the condition of the road and taking into account the improvements that they are going to be doing this summer out there. They want to make sure that that we get out there while the timing is good.
Patrick, can I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
How will you coordinate that timeline with the corridor improvement?
Thank you for asking that question. The improvements that we do would be part of our corridor improvements. So so indeed there is no I shouldn't say, I don't know what the proper term is, but no hard and fast schedule specifically for this section of road. Having this agreement amendment with the Nevada Department of Transportation would, of course, make sure that we go down the road to pursuing this corridor in this time frame. Yes.
The original time frame schedule that we presented showed North Carson Street going first. So what we would be proposing is that South Carson would go first, and then we would work to one of the other corridors.
Which is the way it shows in the CIP now.
Right. Yes.
They're flipped.
Yes. That's right.
Mm-hmm. And finally, and actually quite importantly, that this amendment, the last term that we're looking at of significance, is to very specifically confirm what it is we have been assuming, but to have it in writing, that the remaining $7.127 million in payments that were agreed to be paid through 3 cents of the 5 cent gas tax would not begin until phase 2B-4 is complete. So the interchange would have to be constructed before we'd start making payments. And finally, this is a note on the potential design of South Carson Street. The city previously, as part of that, those corridors that we were looking at, developed only very limited complete streets concepts. And with the realization that much more significant efforts would be required at a later date as we approach each of these corridors. We understood that throughout. Given that we know that we're looking to adopt this amendment with the state, you know, as soon as possible, we were able to find a funding source, actually through the Carson Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, for the Carson City RTC, as a member of CAMPO. CAMPO has a funding source, $75,000 budgeted for the next fiscal year, that is available to do a conceptual design only. That's not real design money, just a conceptual design for South Carson Street, because as I indicated, every corridor has its own issues. We have questions that, you know, bigger picture questions that need to be answered for South Carson Street. The completion of that smaller conceptual study will allow us to hopefully pursue grant funding opportunities, hopefully be successful. But this will not accomplish final design. This is only a conceptual study. Final design would have to be completed through a separate effort, and then, of course, construction initiated. And that's it.
Can you help me understand that one a little bit? So you're saying we'd get a grant to have some preliminary professional come in, look at that street area, and give you a couple of thoughts as to what we could do with the road?
And it's not that we have to pursue a grant. We have a source of federal funding that's available to CAMPO annually. It's not something you have to apply for. And a portion of that funding that is available has been set aside to complete this effort. So the concept for the conceptual study, and we're going to pursue a proposal from an appropriate consulting firm, would be to look at the bigger picture questions of, you know, how many lanes? Should there be bike lanes? Is there room for a multi-use path? Should there be big questions like there are no pedestrian crossings on Carson Street all the way from Fairview to Coons? I mean, nothing. So that's definitely an issue. There is also a frontage road on the east side of the road. The question is, what is the future of that? And then there's also, while we don't expect to tackle the subject entirely, we want to make sure that we look at what is the envelope of the right-of-way that exists there today, because there are definitely issues with the adjacent property owners there. So we want to figure out where do we think we stand on right-of-way and how much of it do we need. Those are bigger picture questions.
At what point do you bring all of those diverse business interests, is probably a good way to say, that area just has absolutely different types of businesses that I can imagine all would have a different point of view. Some would love wonderful flowers down the center, while another one would say, don't block my view, because they have vastly different business methodologies. And so at what point do they come in, after this conceptual or during this phase?
There will definitely be a public outreach component of this, I mean, including a public meeting, for example, but it will certainly not be to the point where you're doing the, you know, for example, Danny Rotter did some very, very, you know, one-on-one type of work. You know, as the further you get into the design, there'll be more opportunities for that type of involvement. So while there will be public involvement, it'll be just the beginning of it and appropriate for a planning level study. It won't be the end all be all.
I just want to make sure they have input on the front end, because I know as plans kind of get out the gate, it's harder to change them when you're spending money making detail plans. So the earlier you can involve all of those businesses and landowners, probably the better.
Patrick, during that outreach program, are they going to look at the lease versus purchase option. Many of those parcels along the frontage road have leased parcels currently from NDOT, and when that land is transferred to us, then we're going to have businesses that are going to ask us, can I continue to lease that property, or can I purchase that property? So is that going to be a component of the consultant looking
I don't think they're going to be able to go to the level of detail that you would like at this, as part of this, because of the limited scope and funding that we have available through this funding source. But I do think that we will be able to look at, as I indicated, you know, what right-of-way do we think we need, and identify, you know, some of those parcels that you're talking about, some of them aren't even parcels. They're just portions that have been of NDOT. They're not separate parcels. They're portions of NDOT right-of-way that they're leasing off. So I think the question we'll be able to answer is, do we believe we're going to stay in the same footprint that we are now, and therefore make it possible for that land to be dealt with, you know, as the city sees fit in the future, because there are definitely options there. I just don't think that we're going to solve it for each of those property owners as part of a conceptual study.
Some of those businesses are going to have to retain use of the land because it's the only parking that they have. We had some of the same issues out on Highway 50 East when we acquired that property. Are we going to be able to look at Highway 50 as well? I mean, are we going to try to adapt what we're doing on Highway 50 to South Carson or vice versa when we deal with these NDOT parcels?
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're not dealing with Highway 50 here, but yes, it'll definitely be, we have dealt with this before to a degree, and certainly South Carson has the most of these parcels that we have to deal with, but there are other applicable cases in other portions of the city as well, including, frankly, on North Carson Street. When North Carson was transferred to the city, there are also several properties there that are in a similar situation as well. So yes, this should be, we want to develop something that we can apply throughout the city.
You know, originally, when this is coming forward, I thought it was only going to be dealing with South Carson Street. I do appreciate the information about the from beginning to end. You know, in the future, if PowerPoint presentations are going to be part of the presentation, if we could get these before the board meeting, it'd be great. So it'd be beneficial to know what's going to be discussed so we can formulate questions based upon what is going to be presented. We're presented this today, and citizens also should have the opportunity to look at this material before it's presented. Basically, when my email back to staff had been specifically about amendments and contracts, and I just want to look at and talk basically about amendment number 3, as I mentioned prior to the meeting. So, and it is specifically only to that amendment. And if you could just clarify a few things for me, and that is on amendment number 3, and it's the fourth whereas. I don't know if you have that document. Okay.
I do, just a moment.
No problem.
Okay. All right.
That Carson will continue the $19 million from a combination of cash or debt principal repayment plus interest. If you could just explain that line.
I think what that's referring to is that the so the $19 million was for
the agreement.
The agreement for phase one, and $15 million was for phase two. So I think that all that this is pointing out was that the $19 million was still in effect for phase one.
I think what it was pointing out is a whereas of a factual recitation of what happened.
Right. I just want clarification. That's all I'm looking for. So the next whereas, the obligation through an increase in the county motor fuel tax to be approved by Carson City Board of Supervisors. And what was that increase and how much was it?
Yes, that was the 5-cent increase. I'm just going to go back to my timeline here. It doesn't show it on there, but no. Here, so as you can see on this slide, it shows that the 5-year the five-year gas tax was implemented by the city, consistent with this agreement, in order to continue these payments.
So these whereas are just going through what has already been done before, reminding us of the original agreement and then the ultimate amendments that came forth to get us up to the point where we are now.
And I'm just concentrating on this for clarification purposes only.
Sure.
And then on the next whereas, subsection C, the monthly payment to NDOT contribution of the $15 million for phase two, if you could just tell us what that is about.
Oh, thank you. So we were, what was approved there was a, what we're going to do is use a 3-cent payment to make payments to NDOT for a total of $15 million was the original amount, and those funds would be paid monthly.
And have we made that amount of payment, or what is still owed?
We did not make those payments because, as we indicated in Amendment 3, it's actually a little over $7.8 million was reduced, and the remaining amount of money from that $15 million, which is 7.127, is still owed today.
And that is for South Carson Street and North Carson Street, is that correct? Because the reduction was from Fairview, or from Arrow?
The $5 million of the $7.8 million reduction was specifically related to NDOT not performing the pavement rehabilitation that they originally agreed to do. The remaining $7.127 million in payments are payments related to the completion of phase two of the freeway. Those are not specifically tied to South Carson Street in any way.
Or any other street, is that correct? Okay. There's no page number on here, so. Let me see if there is a page. There's no page number. It's number 8.
What's it say at the top? What's the first line at the top?
The party shall complete.
There you go.
Okay.
Yeah, if you could just explain that briefly, what that entails.
Paragraph 8 says the party shall complete the relinquishments of these portions of state highways in attachment B, attended with everything, goes with them within 18 months of opening of phase two of Carson City Freeway Project. So I'll flip back phase 2B. And what that refers to is Carson Street, and also we don't lose track of this. Snyder also transfers at the same time as South Carson. So what that indicated was that that Carson and Snyder would transfer within 18 months of the opening of phase two. This amendment 4 that is proposed would actually refine that to state that those roads would transfer, and we don't know how many days or months it'll be, but shortly after the opening of phase 2B-3 of the freeway.
I'm sorry. Item 10, number C, NDOT shall credit Carson City in the amount of $5 million. If you could briefly explain that one.
That was the text that we previously discussed, that the total credit provided to the city actually had several elements of what the credit was related to. And C is related to NDOT shall credit Carson the amount of $5 million in lieu of NDOT's performance of pavement servicing, which was previously agreed upon for the portion of Arrowhead Drive down to Fairview. So basically, the debt, rather than resurfacing that roadway as they previously agreed to do, $5 million of the debt owed by the city to the state was eliminated.
And then if you could briefly discuss number 12.
Yes, number 12 specifically relates to the deferral of additional payments in amounting in approximately $7.127 million completion of the project. And that's where, and once again, as part of the proposed Amendment 4, we would specify specifically that those payments would not commence until after the completion of Phase 2B-4, which is the interchange.
And I know staff has received some information from Bob Thrower for a access off of Carson Street down by the freeway. Is that going in, or is that even in discussions or anything?
Thank you for bringing that up. Mr. Thrower has contacted us on several occasions. He is interested in a project that we've already planned to do, and that is the realignment of Snyder to align with Appian Way on the west side of the road. Previous improvements have included the construction of Appian Way on the west side of the road and a northbound to westbound left turn, which actually all will be incorporated in a future intersection. The funding has not been available to complete that, and we would not have done so anyway because the road has been owned by the state. After the road is transferred to the city, it would be possible for the city, as part of the South Carson project, to incorporate that improvement, which we have been interested in many years and planned for, and also Mr. Thrower is interested in as well. And we do see it as a very an important project to pursue for multiple aspects, including access to the businesses, to residences, even for bicycle and pedestrian connectivity. There are a lot of redeeming points related to that. And oh, thank you very much. Thought I made a long enough list, but Supervisor Bronkowski very appropriately has said, and for emergency access, there's a key fire facility just to the east of there, and while there is access currently, it would be far improved with this improvement.
But that in itself would take funding from some other sources, not the freeway. You'd have to get it from street maintenance, or where would the funding come for that?
We haven't actually planned and don't have a budget yet for those South Quarter Street improvements. But approximately $5 million that we expect to come from the Nevada Department of Transportation would be available for use on that entire corridor. And we're going to have to look at the budget for that project after we even get past the conceptual process and potential other funding sources, including, not for that intersection, but utility funds may be a portion of the funding mix, as well as the 8-cent sales tax for capital projects in the city.
But the $5 million, that can be used on that intersection or only on South Carson Street?
No, that is a portion of South Carson Street. That would be an eligible expense. But we do have to remember that the requirements that we need to accomplish within that corridor do include pavement rehabilitation, Americans with Disabilities Act. There are numerous sources of cost in that, and that potential intersection is one of them.
And basically, I mean, for clarification, the negotiations, discussions, however you want to put that, with NDOT and the city or staff can make the final decision on what we want to do with the $5 million. It comes to the board for a board decision?
No, the Regional Transportation Commission would be expected to, in the future, and this is, sometime in the future, eventually award a contract to have a road construction project, but there will be a lot of phases before then, including this conceptual design study, and including, obviously a more detailed design process. And so staff is not making a decision. It will absolutely go through the appropriate entity and contract award and design process and public outreach, and I'm sure we'll get lots of input.
But to clarify, Amendment number 4, which we're negotiating, once we come to an agreement that we feel is fair and equitable, that will be brought to this board for approval.
Yeah. That's what I was leading to. So the decision to take the $5 million and control of the street, however you want to put that, will eventually come to the board for a decision. It is not a staff, RTC, or Campo decision, correct?
Yes, okay. That is correct.
Thank you.
So when you guys are looking at determining whether this agreement is a good idea for the city, is one of the considerations that the $5 million that the state is offering, do you have an analysis that that's sufficient money? Because maybe they budgeted this $5 million in their budget 2 years ago because of their cycle.
No.
How do we know we're getting a good deal to take the $5 million with the roads instead of having them fix the road? That's kind of what my question
is. Yeah, we know the validity of the number because NDOT actually, pursuant to their requirements in these agreements, they fully intended to comply with that agreement, and they actually took a project to 90% design to do this work. So they've had a lot of input from their own materials and design and all their other staff groups in there regarding what would it take to resurface this road in its current configuration. But of course, the configuration that they are planning to rehabilitate is one that is designed to hold 45,000 cars a day in the very near future. Instead of 45,000 cars a day, there are going to be far fewer cars. So they were preparing to pave roadway surfaces to carry traffic that won't exist for very long.
So you're confident that it's the right amount of money that would rehab the section that was their responsibility? What I want to make sure is that it didn't need to be $5.3 million and the taxpayers in Carson are ponying up another $300.
That's still part of the current negotiation. Okay. So we're saying $5 million. It could be 5.3. It could be 4.9. I mean, that's part of what will come back to you ultimately.
And I'll reiterate, to NDOT's credit, they are being very judicious about the need to maintain this pavement and to keep it from failing. And they are separately pursuing a contract for over $1 million to make sure that it remains in a serviceable condition.
Other questions from the board? Does that complete your presentation? I'm going to take public comment. Public comment. Anybody want to talk?
Good afternoon, members of the board, Mayor. My name is Paul McGrath. I'm a resident of Carson for 60 years. I live in the south part of town, and I'm an extreme critic of your Public Works Department and the way they operate. Okay, I need for the city manager to go back to phase one. Right at the start of it. Right, there you go. Okay, an interlocal agreement was made with the highway department to borrow $19 million to assist the state in building the freeway phase one only. What they've done is they've been paying this back, and as of June the 5th, 2005, they've repaid the amount of $13,909,877.60. On that bill of nine, but they, in the middle of the darn thing, they change and went to phase two, where the interlock agreement doesn't allow for any amendments. The only thing it allows for is the repayment of that bill to the state of Nevada, because the Board of Supervisors, with Mayor Texera and also Maseko, assured the citizens of this community that there's not going to be any changes in this thing, and if we need to renegotiate it, you had to come back to the people, because that is a road tax that's governed by the state, and you have use of this because of a bill passed in 1990 allowing you to increase your limit to 9 cents, which you did when you made this agreement. When you went to phase two, you had to come back to the citizens. You just couldn't do it through ordinance. You had to come back to the citizen, go over the whole procedure again, why you need this additional money. What they've done is just rat-holed it, as far as I'm concerned. You've gone through three different amendments, making changes, and you're bartering all the time to get the money that you owe the state down to where you think it's acceptable to the community. And this is not proper, and I believe it's against the Dillon rule in approving this type of taxes.
Paul, my understanding is that argument has been discussed by the DA, and also I just hear third hand that it's also been discussed with Legislative Council Bureau, and neither of those entities agree with that legal conclusion. Now maybe those are third hand comments, except for what I've read from the DA. But help me understand where you are on the legal side of this thing. I mean the legal argument.
The legal side of it, I can't explain from the legal side of it. I really feel that this money has been used for other things other than what the board approved it for. After phase one, or the original agreement, that nickel gas tax was really a bone of contention. Sorry about that. If you start looking at the board minutes in 1997, I mean, there was people just lined up to testify not to do this thing unless you got voter approval. And they did it anyway because the state law allowed for that difference to go from 4 cents that you were getting to 9 cents. And once they did that, they decided to use the 9 cents, and they went in and actually had this interlocal agreement with the state of Nevada to borrow that money from the state to do the construction work on phase one, which was from Lakeview to Highway 50. The city was thought they got a great deal because of all the costs involved in storm drainage problems out on Highway 50. And for anybody who's lived here any length of time, all you had to do was drive out Highway 50 in the middle of a rainstorm, and when you get to about where Sclery's used to be, it's like just driving into a bathtub. I mean, it was just horrible. So the city thought they were saving money by doing this with the state to fix these roads, and that's all it was supposed to be for. You needed additional approval to increase that tax. Each amendment that you put in to work on how you're going to repay the state, and when you go to two. You borrowed more money against the original amount because you went up to $15 million because you wanted to do Fairview Drive. So.
Okay, well, so I think we've been through this a little bit, but, you know, let me just say it like this in a general sense, Paul. The DA has assured, at least me, and I think in front of this board, that those prior, one, the original agreement and the amendments to it were legally done. I mean, I wasn't involved. I mean, I was involved in 2009 with the last one.
Right, because I saw your signature there.
The other two, I think the ones that you're talking about, I wasn't involved in. But right. I'm told by, you know, I got an opinion from our district attorney that those amendments were legally done. Now, I don't know what to say about that. I understand that you're concerned that they might not have been and that they shouldn't have been, but I've got a district attorney who's telling me just the opposite. So help me, gap somehow, so.
Okay, during the administration of Mayor Maseko, this was just being formulated to help the state. And it was, a big push was going on by the people of this community not to increase the tax. But through negotiations with the state and also with the community, they were able to get approval to increase this tax to a nickel. A nickel is already on the existing tax. Okay, now during the 8 years that the mayor, Maseko, was in office, the board changed. And Mayor Maseko was the only one who remember the start of this thing to show that these taxes that are being collected for the freeway had to be paid. Now, when he right at the last minute, I mean, he was in the last month of his term. You had a board meeting. Councilwoman Aldine ran a request through to reduce the amount of money that's being paid to the state and use that for RTC projects as opposed to paying off the freeway. This is where your Second Amendment comes in. Now, there was a lot of pushback even from Mayor Maseko because he remembered the commitment that he gave to the community that this money was going to be used only for phase one. Okay, well, they overrode him. She did an awful lot of lobbying. It's all in the minutes. They're all here. They're all in the business. And they were able to go ahead and change that to go into allowing, by passing another ordinance, instead of going back and getting another agreement with the state of Nevada or your interlocal agreements and notifying the public as to what they're doing, they just did it through the means of passing an ordinance. Now, that even comes into question, because when that ordinance was advertised in December of 2004, the advertisement started out, it's hit like most of these agendas with public works. You know, you got to figure out what the hell's going on before you you can figure out how they're spending our money. It was advertised to say about in the middle of the agenda as a change in the road tax that was being collected. Okay, that's fine. I mean, that was basically the reading number one of a bill. Then they come at the 16th of December, and they completely agendize this thing under a different category as phase two of the bill. And a comment made in the minutes says, it appears that we do not have any public opposition to this, and we're going to go ahead and approve this, that being the phase where they took the money that they were being paid the state of Nevada and renegotiated for the second phase of the construction. And that was...
Would you agree with me that the original agreement allows for an amendment upon agreement of both parties?
The original agreement doesn't allow for amendment. There's a clause in there that they can negotiate in the original. Now, this is actually in your interlocal agreement.
Yeah.
I think it's in
Section
about,
15.
Huh?
Section 15
yeah,
says you can modify it only upon a written agreement of the parties, right?
Yeah.
You agree with that?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
But it's standard lawyer talk. That's all it is. That's how I look at it.
Okay. All right. Rick, is there anything you want to add there? Mr. McCann.
Let me change gears for a second. My name is Rick McCann, Nevada Association
apologize.
Of Public Safety Officers.
Mr. McCann.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I've not done this, what, 1,000 times? Not here. Let me make a personal comment. First of all, thank you, Patrick. Is that your name? For providing the information. I've learned some additional things here today, which is one of the reasons why I came in here with Paul, to learn some additional things. Number two, it gave me a chance to dry. As many of you do. And number three, personal comment, I represent law enforcement, and for those of you who attended the memorial that Sheriff Furlong gave some very eloquent comments about, I appreciate you being there. Now, to this issue. Let me shift gears for a second. I sat here and listened. Now, this is the second time. You may remember I was here several weeks ago. Correct me if I'm wrong. What I see is the city bartering down its debt, for lack of a better term. It's not a bad thing. Bartering down your debt. With NDOT, while taking on more responsibility to repair these roads and these streets, some of which are state streets, roads. Can the city effectively do that? I guess I'm just asking that question as any citizen, or in my case, I don't live up here, but I have business up here, I have an office up here on Fairview. I guess my question is, I heard doom and gloom last time I was here about your streets and the inability to some extent of being able to repair them in an adequate time frame. Yet I now see that you're bartering down, essentially negotiating down, your debt with NDOT. Great thing.
Money has to come from someplace, Rick.
It does. But what I'm saying is the infrastructure capable of handling it?
I agree, but I mean, let me just say this. I mean, if it's an arm's length transaction between two parties,
mm-hmm.
What's the legal issue that you'd ask us to look at as to whether or not I can barter it down? Is there a state law, a county law that you'd ask us to look at?
I'm not, I made this representation before, Mayor, that I don't have a particular problem. I fully respect the fact that Mr. Woodbury was here last time and looked you right in the eyes collectively and said, I've given you my opinion and it's your responsibility to take his opinion. Fully agree with that. I have no quarrel with that. I'm just asking, not so much of a rhetorical question, I guess it needs an answer from a transparency standpoint, but are you capable of taking on the additional risk, the additional work, while you're lowering your debt? That's a concern I would have as somebody who occasionally drives these roads. Should NDOT remain on the hook to do their part rather than you taking on? I think it's extremely good that you're lowering the debt base, but you're also providing your infrastructure the responsibility to go out there and do things that I heard before you may not have the ability of doing. That's a concern. That's a concern from my standpoint, which is why during public comment, I offer that to you. back on 11-10 of 04, which I just saw on your thing there, the board voted to remove the sunset of 5%, a 5-cent fuel tax, and fund roadway projects into the long-term future. I guess a question I have is what projects have been funded through that removal of the sunset? One of the things we had asked for before is can we see what's been funded? And I think there was some debate back and forth, some dialogue from the board as to whether that would be a cumbersome exercise to provide that, which ones were really from that 5%, 5 cents, which ones were from other areas. I fully understand that. But that's something we had asked for. I had asked for before when I was here. I don't know that Mr. McGrath or any of his constituent base, if you will, people who support this concern, have received that. I would again ask that there be some breakdown, if it can be accomplished, to show with that 5 cents. It was not sunsetted in order to provide for roadway projects into the long-term future. Which ones? Which ones have been done, which ones are earmarked to be done from the 5 cents? I think that is something that might very well satisfy some of these people.
Where does it say, Rick, that it's that the sunset at 5 cents should be earmarked?
I believe so.
Where does it say that?
It does not say that. I'm saying from a transparency standpoint, I think it makes some of these people happy to say, oh, that's the road that was done for that. Okay, now I see the 5 cents as being done the way it was proposed. That's all I'm asking.
I got two lights up here. You want to go and then?
Sure.
Lori, then. Lori, go.
So I want to say that I've been giving this issue a lot of thought, that we've had numerous agenda items that have been brought before us that have all been non-action items. And so it's difficult sometimes for people to maybe believe that we're being transparent or providing information that the public is requesting. I think we are transparent, and so I don't have a problem giving you an action item for discussion so that all of the public that is interested in discussing this issue can come forward. And I don't think we've done anything wrong as prior boards, current board, any boards, but I also believe that the public has a right to information, and so for pure transparency reasons, I'll be happy to work with staff to develop, and Mr. Shirk or you, Paul, or whoever, on an agenda item that we can take action here as a board if that's what you and the people that signed your petition are looking for. And maybe that's enough for today. I don't know.
The nickel gas tank was supposed to expire. You know, and that was the only reason it got approved way back when. I mean, the citizens were really upset with this thing. And to continue it on without their approval, and then where's it now? Where's the nickel now? We're still getting the money every month. You know, we're still getting it every year. We're getting millions of dollars. We're talking about a $30 million hit on our taxes for we don't have any accountability for it.
I think we'd be happy to provide some answers.
Hmm? I'm sorry, Lori.
So the interlocal agreement, Paul, that you mentioned, paragraph 15, item 15, clearly gives the parties the ability to change the agreement. I'll read it into the record. This agreement shall constitute the entire understanding between the parties, and no modification shall be binding unless in writing and signed by the parties. So clearly the parties have the ability to amend the agreement, and clearly they did. Three times, and they're working on a fourth. So what I'm hearing you say, and I appreciate your frustration and I appreciate your concerns, but you're arguing against past policy decisions that were made that were legal and binding and within the authority of the groups that made those. There's nothing that we can do about that. I understand what Lori's saying, that she's more than willing, and Jim has said this too, that they're more than willing to work with you to get you the information that you would like to see. But what's frustrating for at least me up here is to hear you continue to tell us that we did something wrong, because we didn't, and previous boards didn't. It's very, very clear that they had the authority to do what they did. You may disagree with it, but that's your opinion. That's not factual that they did something wrong, which is what you have accused us of. So I would just ask that in the future that you keep your comments to your opinion and not accuse us of doing things that Nobody did.
Thank you, Brad. However, we have to go back to the origination of this thing. Now, you have a Board of Supervisors who govern our city, our capital city, who are making promises to the community. And the, part of those promises from the, both the previous two mayors was that we will not change this thing. And any future boards, I understand you say you can't be held liable for other boards. But this, but they, I mean, it's all in writing. It's all in your minutes that they will not tamper with this thing until the highway department is paid off for, the, for because of this agreement. So, I mean, I'm not accusing you of doing it. I'm just accusing you, the previous board who promised this community that they would take care of phase one of the freeway and then stop. They would have to come back to this if you wanted to have additional taxes or to keep that tax going. That nickel cast tax.
And I appreciate your comments, Paul, but unfortunately, for whatever reason, whatever promises are in the minutes did not make it into the agreement. And so from the point that you have a binding agreement, that is the basis for the actions going forward, and that's what we're dealing with.
Okay. Mr. DA, have you heard anything to change your opinion?
No.
All right.
Come on, Jason.
Anything further? I think Lori's Supervisor Bagwell has indicated, and I know she sat down with you before, Sheriff.
I'm sorry.
I think Supervisor Bagwell has indicated she'd sit down with you if there's something that we could do. I mean, we're not going to, I could tell you right now, and I'm not, if there's something that we can do to help answer some questions, I'm not interested. Interested is the wrong word. I don't see how we can go back and undo a board issue given the legal situation where we are right now. I just don't. But going forward, I think that, you know, there's things we can do. So, but well, I'd be happy to, whatever you guys come up with, as far as me.
You know, in previous conversation, I asked the board to, you know, we've got some serious road problems out where I live, you know, and we've got this nickel gas tax running around this community that's not being accounted for. For Christ's sakes, all they ask is that the Public Works Department develop a plan for the community. And we don't have to be number one, and I think I asked this before. But just show us when you're going to do something, you know. And I've got some real concerns about, you know, I mean, you did a wonderful job on Washington Street. I mean, that road is perfect. But you come out and look at a street that they just did, quote, unquote, that exits off of the Snyder Bridge. You know, you just did it last year. There's already big holes in it. I mean, it's just to get us off your folks' back. I mean, the quality of that work is horrible. But Washington Street is great. Now, if you could do the same thing out there and make those streets like that, I think we'd be pretty much pleased out there. It wouldn't quit bothering you. But it's up to you folks to make the decisions.
Who did the Snyder Road?
I think he's referring to a portion of Roland, which is just
right,
east
right.
of Snyder. That was not a reconstruction project. That was a micropaving or a slurry versus Washington.
Right. It's already coming up.
Yeah. All right.
Mayor, my only comment, passing comment, remember I get paid by the word. And I don't get paid anything for this.
Well, sit down and talk for a while, then. That's okay. Go ahead.
I'm telling you.
You need that. Your coat needs to get drier, so
I know,
go ahead and
I know.
Talk.
I'm just hanging out. I did hear Patrick or one of these gentlemen indicate, I think in response to maybe Ms. Bagwell's comment, Supervisor Bagwell's comment about they don't really have a plan for some of this stuff coming up. Well, I guess that's probably natural. You can't anticipate everything.
I didn't hear that. I did not hear that.
I thought you might, one of the supervisors asked a question, and for some of the road areas, they're still planning. They're still deciding what's going to be done. That's why they haven't come up with a full Amendment 4 yet.
On the other, right.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's what I'm referring to, sir.
All right.
I think that's natural, but by the same token, I think you just said it. You can't maybe fix the past. It's understandable. But going forward, I think Supervisor Bagwell's offer should be accepted, will be accepted, and if we can work with the appropriate individuals to get the base individuals that I'm just here offering some thoughts about, get them some feeling about what you've done and what you're doing with the money in question. I think that would probably make a lot of people satisfied.
All right. Supervisor Shirk.
It's not that there was a comment made that Lori's willing to sit down with Ms. McGrath. That's not the case. What she did indicate is that she's willing to second my motion to have an agenda item to talk about road repair. I believe that's where we're at.
Agreed. No, I don't expect her to sit in someone's living room or in her office and do it, but providing the forum to have that discussion, that dialogue open on an open forum, with appropriate notice and whatnot, I think is what these people should have. And if they're interested, they'll show up. They'll offer their comments through Paul or through themselves. But that's going forward in a positive direction,
right.
I think.
All right.
And just to mention, Mr. McGrath, they are going to fix your street pretty close to your house there, Appian Way. I believe that's in the works. Is that not correct?
Yes, actually, that is correct. There's actually an item on the agenda next week, the RTC, the Carson City RTC, which does the work programs. We have an item on the agenda next week to discuss the work program and the use of various funds that are available for roads, and Appian Way is included on that.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. Further public comment? Anybody? Anybody? I don't see, Rick, good to see you. Did you dry off, Rick?
I'm dry now.
Okay, all right.
Get wet again.
Thanks. Thank you for your comments about the law enforcement memorial. Well received. Thank you. All right. All right. All right. We'll close the item out on this matter and then move to the next agenda item, which is the report of each condition, report of the condition of each fund in the Treasury. Anybody have any questions of Nancy Paulson?
No, I'll give you a motion.
Motions, public comment? Hearing none, motions in order. Supervisor Bagwell.
I move to accept the report on the condition of each fund in the Treasury and the statements of receipts and expenditures through April 22, 2016, per NRS 251.030 and NRS 354.290.
Motion, second on the motion. Discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Okay, let's take up 26B. This is CIP, Capital Improvement Program for years 2017 through 2021. Ms. Paulson, you want to take us through there?
Good afternoon, Nancy.
Sherry with you there, so.
And Sherry Russell is
she'll,
here.
She'll make sure that you stay on track. All right.
Nancy Paulson, Chief Financial Officer for Carson City, and I have Sherry Russell, the Deputy Chief Financial Officer. And we also have Pam Ganger, which I haven't introduced before, one of our county managers. But so this is the annual update for the city's capital improvement program, which accompanies the city's annual budget. Pursuant to NRS, the city is required to file a five-year capital improvement plan with the Department of Taxation each year by August 1st. The first year of the plan, in this case fiscal 17, must match what the city has budgeted in capital outlay in each fund in the 2017 budget. So the capital improvement program sets forth proposed expenditures for constructing, upgrading, expanding, and replacing the community's infrastructure, as well as other one-time capital purchases that are more operational in nature, such as equipment for the sheriffs or alternative sentencing and office equipment. So the following slides will focus on the first year of the capital improvement plan, which must be incorporated into the fiscal 17 budget document. They're broken out by fund or funding source, some of which are restricted for very specific purposes. So we'll start first with the general government capital improvements to be funded from the 5-cent property tax for capital projects and available funding from the general fund. No, just okay. Yeah. But first we need to talk about what may or may not be available in the general fund for the capital improvement plan. So this general fund long-term analysis is based on the most recent C-tax revenues for February 2016. Year to date, we are at 8.4% over the prior year. So based on those revenue projections, we will not be able to get to the 8.3% ending fund balance reserve in the general fund and still be able to fund capital improvements. Staff is proposing a 7% fund balance reserve for fiscal 17 and a $630,000 transfer to the capital projects fund. While 7% is not ideal, it is 40% or $1.3 million more than what we had budgeted for ending fund balance for fiscal 16. In addition, as a result of the city's very conservative budgeting methods, or maybe just a lot of luck, Actual general fund ending fund balance has come in above 8.3% for at least the last 10 years and is projected to be 8.28%, which you could round to 8.3 for fiscal 16. So if you note in the slide, we haven't included any additional CIP funding for fiscal 18 through 21 in order to try to increase the ending fund balance reserves. In addition, the debt service paid by the Capital Projects Fund will be paid off in fiscal 17, which will free up $230,000. And the revenues in this fund could be used for debt service on an issuance of up to $3.5 million in 10-year medium-term obligations, but that wouldn't be until fiscal year 18. So keeping all that in mind, for the Capital Projects Fund, we are projecting a total of $1,021,998 in available funding.
Can you go back? I'm sorry. Can we ask questions as we
sure,
go?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. So on the CIP funding, we're going from 730 down to the 100,000, but what was it in 2016 and 2015?
The CIP, 775,000, I think it is, for this fiscal year. And I think in fiscal 15, we didn't do any transfer. Right. It was just the funding from the Capital Projects Fund, property tax.
We're dropping it down to the 100,000 so we can increase the ending fund balance percentage-wise, correct?
That's correct. And then we should have available funding in fiscal 18 from the property tax to issue medium-term obligations.
And generally speaking, CIP funding funds what? That line item.
The general government improvements.
Everything from vehicles for the sheriff to an ambulance to, you know, major building, like we have roof repairs this year. So really all those major capital projects in addition to the 100,000 that goes into the extraordinary maintenance fund.
But by reducing that amount, we're creating more of a backlog of vehicles that we're going to have to replace and other improvements or repairs that we're going to have to do. If we reduce this amount from 775 or the 730 from those 2 years, something's going to suffer along the line, or are we going to be good and comfortable, everything's going to be okay?
Maybe. We budget very, very conservatively, as we've said several times. So I believe there's only a 4% increase in the C-tax for 18 through 21. We're coming in at 8.3% this year. So that's almost double. So this is worst case scenario kind of thing. If our projections, which are very conservative, come true, yes, we might not have money for CIP. So it'll be up to you guys if you want to have that fund balance a little lower to allow us to buy stuff, or if you want to keep the fund balance growing, and then we'll stick with that 100,000 CIP.
In general, I know in 2015 there was nothing there, but prior years, has there always been a line item here or a dollar amount or a fund in that line item? I mean, over the 100,000, let me put it that way.
Generally, I think almost every year there's been some CIP funding, maybe not. In fiscal 13, 14, I don't have that information with me here.
And the $230,000 you said will be paid off, and where would that, what does that pay off, and how much money or funding does that leave that does not go to that debt payment, and where is that money going?
So that debt service payment is coming from the Capital Projects Fund, which is funded by the 5-cent property tax. And that will get paid off in 2017. And then that money would be available to issue.
And what does that pay off, I'm sorry?
2017.
And then once that's paid off, then that funding will go where?
Well, that could be used to issue additional debt for capital.
Does that come to us for board approval, or how does that transpire?
Yeah, that would have to come to the board two times to pass the ordinance, and it has to go to the Department of Taxation. Right. so $391,000.
Nancy, just as a brief comment on that, so that everyone is clear on what that discussion just was, what we're showing here is additional money over the nickel that is dedicated to CIP. So I don't want the public to assume that we don't do CIP and that we're reducing where we've been. We've just been concentrating on trying to meet some backlog of our needs. And so we're taking the general fund and transferring it to the CIP account. So just so everyone's clear, there's the regular nickel that's the actual dedicated CIP.
That's correct. And then in prior years, when we've had excess fund balance over the 8.3%, we have used that to transfer for capital.
And just a clarification as well, that conversation that just took place was on the fiscal year 2018 numbers, which we're not making decisions on today. So we're not actually lowering anything to 100,000. That
right.
happens in the budget process for next year. We're only making decisions about the 2017 budget now.
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay.
All right, so department requests for this funding were submitted to finance at the beginning of the budget process. The 2017 requests were reviewed and prioritized by a group of department directors, which included Public Works, Fire, and Sheriff, and then reviewed with the city manager. So some of the factors that were considered when we were ranking the capital requests included health and safety, if the project was legally mandated, the facilities or equipment maintenance or replacement that is essential to avoid facility or equipment failures. A total of $6.8 million was requested by departments from this funding source. We are recommending $903,441 be funded from the priority listing and 118.
Sorry, Nancy, can you go back one slide? Could you just clarify the general fund transfer of the 630?
That was from that was included in the 730,000 from the prior slide.
Right. Okay.
So, yeah. So 100,000 is going to extraordinary maintenance fund, and then the 630, we would like to transfer. We're recommending transferring to the capital projects fund. And then we would have 118,000 to be allocated to a break fix account for emergency repairs.
Can you tell me how much we have left in this year's break fix?
It's around 40, between 40 and 50,000.
That we have left
yeah.
this year?
Okay. So this is the priority listing that we came up with, and it stops at, there was 105 items, but it stops at the 903,000 that we have available for funding. And this list includes 4 sheriff vehicles, 1 ambulance refurbish and re-chassis, a refurbished fire pumper truck, the aquatic facility roof replacement and restoration. The total amount of this project is actually $535,000. And on this listing, you'll just see $195,000. That's because we've budgeted the other amounts in the Quality of Life Fund and Extraordinary Maintenance Fund. It also includes a public safety complex boiler and Sheriff Department and Alternative Sentencing Public Safety Equipment. And just an additional comment, any of the items that are approved during the CIP process will also need to go through the city's purchasing and contracts approval process as required by city policy.
And Nancy, on this sheet here, page 4, the vehicles that are on here, well, actually, back up a little bit. Out of the items, out of these 17 items, this is a discussion that department heads have within a group meeting where they determine where they're going to pick and choose and what they're going to do with this money. Is that correct?
Right.
Departments get together and decide universally what we're going to do with this money, correct?
It did include all the department heads, but it included several. And what they did was they went through and ranked each of the 105 items, and then we put all that together to come up with the ranking that you see here.
And out of these 17 items on this sheet, any purchase of any vehicle, this is only a temporary, it comes, the contracts and everything for the purchase of those vehicles come to the board for approval. This is just to move forward to the next step. We're not buying anything yet.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Nancy, can you tell us what the asterisk on number five is? Because sorry, I just couldn't find it.
Yeah, so what that is the ambulance fund has $30,000 in an equipment line item in this fiscal year, and that will be able to be moved over to next year to pay for the rest. That was originally $125,000. Any other questions on the capital projects fund? So next we're going to move on to other funds that have more specific restrictions as to what type of capital improvements they could pay for. So the transit fund, these funds must be expended in accordance with federal and state grant provisions, which along with a match from the general fund make up most of the revenue in this fund. The recommended capital improvements for this fund were developed by the Public Works Department, and they include bus purchases, facility upgrade, fuel facility, and bus stops. Next is the Regional Transportation Fund. The revenue source
Can we go back? Mm-hmm. Are we going to get more of an explanation on these items? Or should I ask for that right now?
I believe that the departments are here to ask any more detailed about the actual project.
Yeah, I would like to get more information on the facility upgrade and the fuel facility.
Darren Schultz, Public Works, for the record. I'm sorry, I didn't hear which one you wanted more information on.
The facility upgrade, which I believe is moving...
Transit?
Yeah.
Yes.
Over to the animal shelter and then the fuel facility.
Okay, very good. I'll start with the transit facility project. What we're contemplating with this and budgeting here is the old animal control facility that is on the corner of Buddeye and Fairview Edmonds there. It's going to move into its new location late this year, and it will free up that space there on the corner. Our current transit operation is located within the gates, the fence of the corporate yard, and it's located in a kind of an old house-like looking building that's been there for longer than anybody that works here. And so we've struggled with getting people that are coming to talk to the transit operator about buses or pickup. We've struggled with just ADA compliance and getting them parked in a parking lot and into that rather old, dilapidated building. So what our plan is once the animal services move, that we would relocate the transit operations down to where the current animal services are. So our plan, or what we're suggesting, is that operations would move there, all the buses would park down there on that corner as well, and then it would also allow for residents to easily access the transit operator. You can pull in a parking lot and you can walk or take your wheelchair to a ADA compliant building.
So the old house, the plan is to demolish that, correct?
That will be demolished.
Okay, so but what is the $100,000 figure based on?
That is us taking a look at what is over at the existing animal control facility. That's our estimate of what it would take to make that into a JAC operation center.
Seems really low.
Well, you have to remember a lot of that over there is animal related, and it just going to be demoed. We're not fixing that stuff up. We're just the, you know, basically the one building is what we're going to make into an operations center. It's all the rest of that stuff is just completely going away.
So the old kennels get demolished and just the current admin building with the cat facility?
That's right.
Correct. Talking about
that's right.
Correct.
And have all the environmental issues been mitigated there?
Yeah, if you remember, we did the asbestos mitigation of the kennel. So that's all getting knocked down. That steel building was just renovated not too long ago, not renovated, but upgraded not too long ago. So it's actually in pretty decent shape. But the rest of them are going to be knocked down.
So, Darren, do you think that you can use a lot of the current build out in that admin building, or are you going to need to gut that building and rebuild offices in it?
The plan is to is a bit of a combination of both, and Patrick just updated me here. So it's he was looking at this project as an 80% reimbursed project. So this is just the city's portion.
So this is the match
of what we're
see,
spending.
That makes sense.
No. It's not the match. It's just the money that would come back to us.
Yes.
Correct.
Total is 180 reimbursed.
Total is 180,000. 80,000 would be reimbursed.
Is that right?
I mean, 80,000 out of the 100,000 is a revenue source to fund the project.
Comes from
federal transfer. Oh, pardon me. Patrick Pittenger, yes, that is correct. The total estimated cost is $100,000. We haven't done the design yet, but indeed we have federal funds budgeted in the amount of 80% of that total.
I can just ask. So what I want to understand is, why would I spend $20,000 to general fund? We can maybe go that way too. So you're saying the existing building where Jack is not ADA compliant?
Well, it's very, very borderline. We've tried to make it work under the circumstances of what we have. We don't have a public parking lot that's close to the building, so they park outside of the corporate yard, and then they kind of wind their way into the building. The building sits down in a hole, so we've made it work, and it works. It just doesn't work well.
So maybe I'll ask a different. So how many customers or clients per day do you receive at the Jack office?
If I may, you know, there might only be a dozen or so a day, but some of the issues that we have with the building that Darren referred to, the location of it, if a person is on a Jack bus currently and wants to get to the Jack office, it's not on a Jack route. There is quite a walk from the nearest Jack route to this office. The proposed new location would be closer to the nearest Jack route, so that would be easily walked. You'd actually go Desitoy to Fairview. And then we do have just ongoing operational issues that you experience with an older building, whether it be IT or plumbing or what have you. It's I guess, the opposite of a purpose-built building, whatever that would be.
So we still have some concerns about the $100,000, though, because $100,000 doesn't get you anything in construction. I mean, that's going to get you a paint job and a new roof. So have you looked at some designs and some preliminary cost estimates, or what is that number based on? Or are we just picking a number that we think is going to accomplish what we want?
I think the intent is it's going to get us in the door. It's down the road. There's going to have to be some tweaks and some changes to make it ideal. But for $100,000, we're comfortable with the site. We can demo the stuff that we don't need. We can get in that administration building, make some minor things to make it work for us. We can get it so all the buses can park there, and we're in a new location. We are not suggesting today that, you know, down the road there's not going to be other things that we need to modify there, but our goal is, you know, to get it 80% of it paid for by federal grant.
And then the fuel facility?
So the fuel facility is something that's been on the burners for many, many years, maybe as long as I've been here. And what we're, as we continue to prepare for emergency readiness, we've been, something that's concerned us is that in the event of a major emergency, earthquake, whatever it is, we are completely 100% reliable. We are relying on public gas stations to provide fuel to our first responders. We don't have any sort of a backup. We don't have any tanks of our own where we store fuel and we can go to. So what we've been told, and we've had studies done in terms of emergency response, is that you really should figure out a way to get get control of some of your own fuel so that you can, you monitor who gets it, who uses it, and how fast it gets used. So what we're bringing forward here, it hits this fund, it hits a number of the other funds, is to build a fueling facility in the corporate yard that will only be used and only can be used by city fleet vehicles, including fire department, sheriff, et cetera, where we have full control and access of it, and there's no fuel middleman in terms of our fleet department, fleet division, will be contacting the trucks. The fuel comes and unloads directly in there. There will be no Texaco in the middle or Shell or anything, the way it's being worked now. So that's the number one reason is the emergency response. Number two is we do anticipate being able to save some money in any sort of a markup on the fuel when it's where it's coming directly to us. That's kind of a minor thing. But overall, it's to get something that's under our control.
So the figure that's in the CIP is $500,000 over 3 years. Again, what is that number based on? Is that based on any preliminary estimates, or are we just picking a place marker and hoping that we can get there in 3 years?
No. What we did specifically for this is we have done preliminary engineering drawings, layout of what this would cost, and then we went out and talked to vendors who provide fuel tanks, who provide fuel pumps. That's all been pinned in there so that we're comfortable with that $500,000 number.
And you mentioned that the cost savings is secondary, but have you looked at that? Have you looked at a cost benefit analysis on that to see what the savings might be?
We have not.
No. And then since you have a preliminary design, how many gallons are we talking about and how many tanks? You're going to have three different tanks? You're going to have diesel and two grades of...
That's correct. Diesel and regular fuel. We're talking about either having three or four pumps available for cars to come. We're also looking at, you know, a small canopy over the pumps, so when you pull up, if it's, you know, inclement weather, you don't have rain or snow going on you. And I believe we were looking at two tanks, a total of three tanks. And they all have to, you know, tanks nowadays, the protection is in terms of, you know, you don't want anything to go into the ground. So it's they're the standard tanks that's acceptable today.
Double-walled tanks.
Oh, yeah.
So do you know if the city is eligible for the Nevada Petroleum Fund, or do we self-insure, or are we looking at a third-party insurance vendor for any environmental issues?
I don't know the answer to that. I'm not sure if anybody here knows that either. I don't know the answer to that.
We should take a look at that because that's a serious concern. I own a property where there's fuel tanks, and it's a major concern.
All right.
Darren, and this fuel tank will only be to accommodate emergency vehicles, correct? Not on a daily operation?
No. It will be used on a daily operations for public works, parks, and emergency operations, sheriff, and fire. But the idea is we keep those tanks as full as possible. If there's an emergency, all of a sudden, non-essential vehicles aren't going to get any fuel out of that. That fuel tank is going to be reserved for first responders.
So it's an everyday use?
Yes.
Okay.
Until there's an emergency, yes.
And then it goes to emergency.
Right.
Okay. On the going back to the facility upgrade, that $100,000 does not cover the demolition of the old existing building at Public Works, correct?
It does not.
And the $100,000, you're hoping to get reimbursed or a grant fund back from the federal government at $80,000?
Yeah. Of the $100,000 that we have budgeted there, $80,000 will be reimbursed from the federal government. So it's basically a $20,000 hit to the general fund.
Thank you.
So maybe I have more of a general discussion on the fuel facility. So that's $550,000 across a three-year system. And so what I'm looking for is an analysis of the viability of needing a fuel facility versus what could I do on a road with $550,000. That's a lot of money. And so while it's there for your emergency backup, if fuel were to happen, what's to say that the fuel facility that we own would not have an emergency and you couldn't access it any more than you could access any other gas station in town, depending on the type of emergency, obviously.
Yeah, let me answer the second part of that first. It's not, we're not worried about accessing the fuel. What we're worried about is essential first responders having to compete with the general public for fuel. For instance, if Carson City cannot get fuel trucks in here because we've got a fault line and we can't get any new fuel trucks into downtown, people are, I wasn't, you know, around, but in the 60s, people lined up to buy, there's fuel shortage, to buy fuel. We don't want to, we feel like we should have the first right of fuel. We can go in. That's not to say, I guess, our sheriff can't go out to a fire or a gas station and, you know, not allow the public to buy fuel and it's only for us. I mean, that's the other side of this equation. But the goal is that it's not an emergency. It's not going to disable the pumps. An emergency is going to mean we're the only ones that get that fuel. We don't compete with anybody in the public.
I'm just trying to weigh that particular potential emergency need against $550,000 that would go a long way to fix another road.
Yes.
And so why it hasn't been an issue for
it hasn't today? I mean, we haven't run into it. We haven't had the circumstance where it comes up, but it is not uncommon at all for a agency of our size to have a dedicated their own fuel facility. It doesn't mean that's the right thing to do, but it's very common. If you go around and talk to other agencies our size, they typically in their corporate yard or somewhere have their own fuel facility. The fact that we've went this long without it, I can't give you much history there as to why or how. I just know it's been on the books. And then we have, every time we have some sort of an analysis done, being prepared for an emergency, this is a sentence that's written in that response back to us is, you should have your own fuel facility. As far as the $500,000, it is, we did spread that out. You'll notice over a number of funds, it's not just coming out of, you know, transit. I mean, water's paying for some of it, sewer's paying for some of it, transit, streets. I mean, we're trying to gather it all together because everybody will be using that facility. I really believe that this is the direction the city should be going, but I do understand your concern with, should this money be spent somewhere else? I do understand that.
I think that's probably for us to discuss, but we have to discuss it. I can't, right, thank you.
Darren, if the fuel facility went in, is there any cost savings? Should we do that and we buy the fuel bulk with the city? Is there any cost savings? Should we buy it?
There are cost savings, but that's not the reason we're doing this, is for the cost savings. Zach, do you have a number on that?
I realize why you're doing it. I just interested if there was a...
Yeah, Zach Good, Carson City Fleet Supervisor. There is going to be some cost savings involved in that. And long fuel bulk loads, I'll be almost able to save about 10 cents a gallon. And then I actually can control my fuel cost because I can pit my fuel companies against each other, so I can lower it substantially. And the fact of, you know, 10 cents a gallon, and we're averaging probably anywhere between 8,000 to 10,000 gallons a month, you're looking at about $800 to $1,000 a month in savings just right there.
So there's a cost savings to the city, but generally speaking, where do you buy your fuel? Just at the local gas station?
We're on a card lock contract, so we can purchase from several CFN stations around town. We have about 7.
When you purchase that gas out in town, are you paying the nickel tax on the gas?
We're tax exempt.
So there is, it wouldn't hurt. What I'm leading to is, even though we do this, put the fuel facility in, and there's a cost saving there, we're not losing any money on the tax revenue going the other side, correct?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I was leading to. Okay. If there's no other questions on the fuel facility or the building, can you tell us about the bus stops now, since we talked about everything else?
Yeah, smallest number, hopefully least amount of time. We've made numerous improvements at numerous bus stops around town, whether they be shelters or benches, garbage cans. We actually did some solar-powered lighting at seven of the shelters recently, because now our service goes to 7:30 in the evening, and while it's light out, you know, some parts of the year, other parts of the year, it's dark by then. There is not a specific project assigned to that, but that could buy us a couple of shelters or more benches. We haven't figured out exactly which location or locations we'll go after, but we do believe that we will continue to make improvements to the bus stops as we go forward.
If I were to use, not build a fuel facility, how much money would that free up for roads in terms of what's unrestricted? I mean, for anything else, I could call it roads, but call it something else. How much money? Because a lot of it is stretched across dedicated sources of funds.
Yeah. Right, right.
Looks like so, 280. Yeah.
I was going to say 250, maybe.
Yeah, it looks like 280. Mm-hmm.
Because the transit funds can't be used for roads.
No.
All right.
They also, Danny just brought to my attention, the other thing that we did consider was for our water resource recovery facility, we're backing that all up with generators so that is an essential service that doesn't, you know, should we lose power, that continues to run. The intent was to have a fuel source close to provide those generators. Those will run for approximately 30 hours before we'll have to fuel them up again. I mean, it's not that we can't drive a fuel truck from downtown Carson Street or wherever closest and drive it over there, but the intent was to have fuel closer that it would be more convenient. So any more questions on this?
Anybody on this? Because we're going to take a break and then we'll come back. So
just one question from me.
We'll take a break.
If you use a card system to get your gas anyway at specific stations, how much of a challenge is that in an emergency situation? How many other people have those type of cards in order to purchase gas?
Well, those cards that we use for fuel, that's also, those cards are giving to the public as well. It's not just for government use. It's any, all the dealerships have cards, all the big, you know, anybody that has fleet vehicles, they all use the same card lock that we do.
Be in recess for about 10 minutes. going to call a meeting of the Board of Supervisors back to order. I think we're on Street Maintenance Fund. Let's see, where are we?
RTC. Are we done with the transit?
RTC.
Regional Transportation Fund.
We're done with transit, yeah. RTC.
Okay. So speaking of fuel tax, so they're, yeah, or not. The revenue source for these capital expenditures is the 9 cent per gallon county option fuel tax that can only be used for street and highway construction and street maintenance. The recommended improvements developed by Public Works include the College and Research Way signal, FLAP, I believe that's a grant program, a local share for Sierra Vista Lane, and the Appian Way, Gonai, and Convair Drive reconstruction.
So as we look at this, on these, the list that we have here, how is this determined as priority? Who, how did this come about?
Well, let's see. Generally speaking, staff develops a prioritized list, taking into account many considerations. But we also work with the RTC. Of course, there's actually an item on the agenda for the RTC for next week, Wednesday. That agenda has been published, and these actions are all approved at one point or another, and sometimes at multiple points by the RTC. So, for example, the College and Research traffic signal that has Maverick on there. That is the result of a previously agreed upon construction of a traffic signal. It was the agreement was signed months ago by RTC, and that budget is consistent with that agreement. That's going to be an annual amount for several years. The FLAP is also the result of actually, frankly, years worth of work trying to find a solution for Sierra Vista Lane. In that case, FLAP stands for Federal Lands Access Program. We actually secured over $4 million of federal funds, but under that program, the federal government spends the money and we reimburse them 5% of the cost. It's a 5% local share during the course of that, and that is the estimated local share during the next fiscal year. So once again, consistent with previous RTC actions and considerations, the last three that are listed there, we're proceeding with two of those as one project. These are consistent with the need to, that is well known by the RTC and in the community as well by the general public, and the need to reconstruct specific roads. We do use a pavement management system, and we have a lot of other considerations, including, of course, the condition of the road. Convair and Gonai are actually going to go out as one project, and then Appian Way subsequently. So, and indeed, these are all funded by that previously aforementioned gas tax, 9 cents, which includes the 5 cents.
So, generally speaking, these come to RTC. They've been approved already. Is that correct? All of these?
Two have, three haven't.
Thank you very much. Yes, two of them have already been previously discussed, and the other three, indeed, the contracts need to be approved by RTC prior to execution, and that those contracts have not been brought to RTC yet. However, we will be discussing it further in an open meeting with RTC next week.
So they could change, potentially. Possibly not, but they could.
Anything is possible.
And as you move forward, does RTC track roads that are done, what ward they're in? Do you track where they're at within the city, or you just do it? And if you don't track it by ward, can you start to track it with these three projects?
We do not track anything by ward. That is not a significant factor in determining which roads should be repaired. We have many other considerations, including traffic volumes, pavement condition, and the like, and a political boundary is not significant to that effort. But it doesn't mean that we don't try to spread the improvements around. These are in very different parts of the city. That is all.
Well, when you say it's not a political issue, I think it is a political issue. For myself personally, well, you mentioned the word political. So in my perspective, representing Ward 4, I really do want to know how much money is being spent on roads in my ward. So why can't we trace where we're doing the road improvements, what ward they're in? What is stopping you from tracking that?
I think perhaps it's a bit of a slippery slope because, I mean, do you want to know how much water money I'm putting in a various ward? How much sewer money I'm putting in a various ward?
Okay,
how about how many?
Let's don't get in an argument here.
Okay.
Let's just answer the question.
I just asked a question.
I'd like to know.
The problem with tracking this project is, or these type of projects in a ward, is the projects don't fall within the boundaries of the ward. They overlap into another boundary. And so, as we've tried to explain before, these projects, they cross those lines. So I could say, well, 30% was here or 70% was there, but that's your guess as well as my guess. We just don't build projects by ward. So that's why we don't track them that way.
All right. Anything further on this fund? Okay. Street maintenance fund?
The revenue sources for these capital improvements are the 1 cent county option fuel tax, the 5.35 cents per gallon state fuel taxes, and a 0.25% sales tax that can only be used for street maintenance activities. So the recommended improvements in this fund are for a truck barn, signals, and another part of the fuel facility.
Patrick. Since this is the street maintenance fund, can't that $150,000 be applied towards street maintenance itself as opposed to a truck barn?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay.
And yes.
All right. Thank you.
Well, can't all the funds in this showing on this piece of paper be applied to street maintenance?
That is correct. I will, you know, specifically regarding the signals, for example, that line item, the signals are a key element of the street system. And what we are suggesting here, while it is listed as a capital item, that is a key element to the maintenance of the street system. And while it's not pavement, it is a key element that needs maintenance.
And Patrick, that's a standard line item. If history tells me, I look back on this to key it out, you always have money for ongoing signal maintenance. So it's really not a new item. It's just that you have to have signal money always.
Well, that it is correct, Supervisor Bagwell, that we do budget money on an annual basis for our signals. But in this case, this is actually, we did not have this specific $100,000. This is actually replacing significant components. Capital components within the system versus the more routine day-to-day maintenance. And I will note that it doesn't show up on here, but previously at the RTC, we actually did receive funding from the Nevada Department of Transportation to replace, I believe it was a couple $100,000 worth of controllers for all of our traffic signals, and that process is underway.
Okay.
Is there any other funding sources to the street maintenance fund?
Just the few that I've already mentioned, the 1 cent county option fuel tax and the 5.35 cents state fuel taxes and the 0.25% sales tax.
And annually, in 1 year annually, what does this fund, street maintenance fund, usually collect totally in a year?
Glad I just opened my book. 2.8 million. Oh, I'm sorry. Approximately 4 million.
That's not just street maintenance fund, that's the whole thing. I mean, he's asking.
That's the street maintenance fund.
Okay.
It's the sales tax revenue and the fuel tax.
Okay. All right. Gotcha. Okay. All right. Go.
All right. I think we're done with the public works portion of our presentation.
Quality of life.
So the quality of life fund, the revenue source is the quarter-percent voter-approved sales tax for the Quality of Life Initiative. These improvements were developed by the Parks Department with input from the Parks and Recreation Commission, and they include a riding lawnmower, a portion of the aquatic facility roof, and open space land acquisition and equipment.
Why isn't the aquatic facility roof being funded totally out of Quality of Life?
They don't have enough funding available to cover the entire $535,000.
You want to put that on the record, Mr. Roger?
No, that is correct. In fact, the using the $239,000 depletes all of our undesignated funds as well.
And how much annually does we collect out of the Quality of Life? What does that bring in annually?
Is this all the funds? Sorry. Sorry, 2.5 million.
And generally speaking, if it's that fund has been depleted because of the MAC reimbursement of the MAC Quality of Life for the construction of the new MAC building, is that why that revenue stream has been lowered, or the funding has been lowered?
The MAC, a large portion of the MAC was there were bonds that were issued for that, and the payment is approximately $500,000 per year.
But funding from the Quality of Life also went to the MAC, did it not?
Correct.
Certainly can.
Yes, that was through the bond proceeds.
Would you like a breakdown on the funding out of Quality of Life? Nancy's correct. There was it's about a $500,000 a year payment towards the, I think it was original $6.2 million bond for the MAC. The portion from Quality of Life towards funding the MAC, I believe, was $6 million and $2.3 million, 2.3 to 2.5 was from the 1/8 of a cent sales tax project. And out of that $2.5 million that we receive in revenues from the MAC, that's broken up into a percentage of 40% of it goes to parks and recreation facilities, 40% goes to the open space program, that's for the acquisition and the management of those properties, and then 20% goes towards the maintenance of park and recreation facilities that were funded through the Quality of Life program.
Maybe let me back up one step then. All I was trying to do was clarify that we only have $239,000 in the Quality of Life because the fund has been, the funding mechanism for the Quality of Life, we've used that funding elsewhere. All that's left in here is $239,000. That's why it's going to the Quality. That's why we have to borrow from other funds to do the roof, because we don't have enough in Quality of Life. That's all I'm saying.
All we have left is $239,000 that we can allocate towards the aquatics facility roof. Now we are,
but that's just in the park capital account, as Roger briefed. Those other accounts are fully funded, and they're ongoing programs, they're ongoing processes that it's not like the fund is depleted.
Yes.
And for an example, the mower, the $60,000 mower, that's coming out of the parks capital account as well.
I think in the future, if we break this down, where the funding's coming on each line item, as we're talking right now. But what I was leading to was because of the money that is coming in on a yearly basis, rather than take out for the aquatic facility roof, rather than take it out of other funds, could we not look at taking out a bond just to do the roof and use the Quality of Life rather than take it from other line items?
I mean, that's possible. I mean, that's a question, I think, really for the finance department, and would be a policy decision by the board.
Yes, we could look into to issuing bonds for that. We would just have to see if there's coverage.
Well, that's the key issue, and I know, for me, that's the key issue, is coverage availability on issuing a bond. But I'm sorry, jump in.
And if I don't know how we're supposed to do this. Could that something we look at?
Sure,
and could you, and when you do look at it, could you get back to all board members of where we're at with that, if you can, please?
Yes, certainly.
Can I just clarify, though, I'm not interested in issuing debt if we have the ability to pay for it outright. So I'm interested in information, but I also want to let the public know I'm not in for going into debt when we have the cash on hand to actually pay for something. I'd rather pay for it than have debt issuance cost. Anyway, I'm just making a comment.
And I was just looking for alternatives. I didn't say I was in favor of it. I said I was just looking for an explanation as to different means.
Okay. Anything else on quality of life? All right.
So the grant fund just has one small item that is budgeted in capital outlay, and that what is from the CDBG grant, the Clear Creek Bowman ADA improvements, and that was already brought to the board on March 3rd.
Let's move to the infrastructure tax.
The infrastructure tax fund, this is the 1/8% sales tax that can only be used for infrastructure projects as outlined in the plan of expenditure. This is the amount remaining. The $532,000 is what's remaining in sales tax revenue for fiscal 17 after the debt service payment of $774,000. So we've just allocated this to the corridor improvement projects.
So does that mean that the total revenue was $1.3 million?
Yes. The extraordinary
maintenance.
So this can only be used for expenses ordinarily not incurred more than once every 5 years to maintain government facilities or capital project. And in this fund, we've allocated the $100,000 to the aquatic facility roof. The residential construction fund is restricted by NRS for park projects, and the current funding, we're just budgeting under undesignated park projects until a project has been recommended by the Parks and Rec Commission. The fleet fund is an internal service fund of the city for fleet maintenance operations, and the recommended improvements are for the fuel facility and vehicle lifts. I also wanted to note that the tentative budget only included capital improvements of $100,000, so we'll have to add an additional $18,000 for the final FY17 budget. But there's plenty of working capital in that fund.
That's only if we approve
only
both expenditures?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, and the lift is for oversized vehicles. We have two lifts currently for regular vehicles, and these are for oversized lifts for, say, fire trucks and jack buses.
Zach again, Carson City Fleet Supervisor. Actually, no, they're not just for heavy vehicles. They're actually, the reason I want these particular lifts is because they're a multi-purpose platform. They can actually lift everything from a sedan to a semi-truck to even a backhoe. So it's versatility, and it gives me a little bit more efficiency.
So the next three funds, the capital improvement programs for the water, sewer, and storm drainage funds were presented to the Utility Financial Oversight Committee on March 15th, where the committee approved the recommendation to the board to approve the 2017 budgets, which include the five-year capital improvement programs. Stormwater includes approximately $570,000 in downtown streetscape and corridor projects. The water fund, the most significant project for fiscal 17 is the east-west transmission main at $1.6 million. And then in the sewer fund for fiscal 17, we have the water resource recovery facility rehabilitation for $15 million and $2.8 million for sewer line and manhole replacement rehab slip lining. So that's the end of my presentation.
And if I may, when you look at both pages 15 and 16, we're spending $18 million in 2017, $14 million, then it decreases down to $2 million, and then comes back up in 2020 and 2021. Why is there such a decrease in 2019?
It's from spending the bond proceeds, right, as we schedule the projects.
Yeah, I believe we're finishing up our state revolving fund money, so I don't know that we'll spend that whole $18 million in 2017, so some of that might move to 18. It might be pushed out a little bit, so that year's just kind of finishing up the state revolving fund money.
The big expenditures, as you know, are the water resource recovery facility, which is underway right now. So that's why you see such big, huge numbers over the next 2 years are for that project. Once that phase of the project is done, the expenditures are going to go way down.
And then we creep back up again.
Yeah.
Because of
future phases, future work.
Okay.
Darren, if you go to the stormwater fund, can you just give us a real quick explanation of the difference between the money under the corridor projects versus the downtown streetscape? I assume one is streets and one is sidewalks.
Good morning, Mayor, Board members. David Bricetta. The corridor projects, we spelled out more information to the utility financial oversight. We broke that out more. But the corridor projects are the remaining, the other corridors, money to be funded through the other corridors. And since when we get better direction on what's going to happen with those other corridors, then we'll be able to target where that money's going to go more specifically. So really that's the money that's the difference between the first three projects and the total amount that's available.
Plug number.
It's a placeholder.
Okay.
And that, Dave, since you're there, can you describe just a little bit of the downtown streetscape for the $89,000?
You know, I'm sorry I don't have the specific details on that. You know, I know that we...
With Mr. Rotter with his iPad.
The Carson okay. Proud.
Danny Rotter, for the record, the stormwater fund across the downtown streetscape is more than that. This is the portion in 17, the stormwater scope of work. There's less pipeline replacements. There's more of the stormwater infrastructure that's newer. So there's a mixture of pipe materials and pipe sizes. Portions of it are upgraded cache inlets, a little bit more capacity. So it's a combination of replacement and capacity, whereas the sewer and the water side is just strictly old infrastructure replacements.
All right, are we ready for public comment on CIP? Public comment, anybody want to weigh in?
Mr. Mayor, ladies and gentlemen, for the record, again, John Barrett. Told you I'd be back on the budget, and I'm here to criticize it a bit, unless it's been changed, and from this review, it doesn't sound like it has. It's doing too little on the long-deferred maintenance of all kinds, particularly roads. I was really impressed with some of the questions that have been asked today, because you're trying to get at that. I have a proposed solution. I don't know whether you're interested in it or not, but I listened to the finance director's references regarding the ending reserve balance, which I like to call a reserve, and you're contemplating increasing it. I understand that in good times, having rainy day fund, or maybe that shouldn't be it, but a reserve is a good thing, and as high as you think is prudent. But we've been going on 5%, state allows 4%, and if you left it at 5%, there'd be more for some of the deferred maintenance. I've talked about this with some people, and I don't know that there's appetite for it, but every dollar counts, as I said this morning. You also could do this, and I think this would perhaps add to the pot that I'm talking about for road maintenance particularly. I know that everybody's betting on the come on the index. We'll see how that goes, but that's like waiting for the halftime jump ball when you're behind 20 points. We're behind on street maintenance. So if this board decided to adopt a resolution saying we're committing excess sales tax money for street maintenance, as you did sort of last year, $375,000, the finance director said the estimates are conservative, and they have been coming in above what have been expected in recent months, and that's why you could do that. If you would pass that resolution, I think it would go a long way toward ameliorating the problems that you have with some of the citizenry. As the great philosopher Yogi Berra said, a nickel ain't worth a dime anymore. And that's the problem. Supervisor Bonkowski said that you can't buy much with $100,000 in construction, and that's for roads, that's for roofs, that's for anything. As I said this morning, I think you all deserve a raise. I'm glad that some of you didn't take it. I say to one who did, that's your right. Go right ahead. I'm not saying you shouldn't. I said that a raise is well deserved. This is a hard job, and you do it well. In most cases, I may have some critical comments here, but I think you're doing the best you can. All these people out here, many of your department heads, are lobbyists. I know you don't look at them that way, and I'm sure they don't want to be called that, but I don't look at lobbyists as bad people. There's one sitting up there right in the middle.
I'm retired.
Oh, of course you are. But, and you're one of the people I've had this discussion with regarding the ending fund balance, and I know we disagree on that. But as far as I'm concerned, until things are paid for that need to be done, the prudent thing to do is to keep that balance above what the state requires, but below what you'd like to go to. And I understand why you'd like to go there. I'd like to have a rainy day fund in my house so that I could pay for things that happen. My car went down not long ago, and I probably deferred the maintenance, which wasn't very smart of me. But I paid the freight, and I probably paid more than if I'd done it on a deferred basis. The real problem is that every year you delay, deferred maintenance is going to cost you, and it's going to cost you more and more. So putting the money away for a rainy day isn't putting a dollar away. It might wind up being putting 75 cents away or 40 cents away, depending how long you let the deferred maintenance last. I thank you for your time. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
I have one.
Good.
Suppose I were to tell you that I could get an increase in our bond ratings of a certain amount if I had if I went back to an 8 or 8.2% ending fund balance. And suppose I further said that or asked you to assume that an increase and your bond ratings would translate into the ability to refinance debt at a lower rate, therefore saving money over the long term. Would your answer still be the same, that we should leave it at 5%?
Well, you're not taking it to 8.3% this time. You're not taking it to 8.3% this time. You're taking it up to 7, and you'll stage it up. That's true.
Well, but John, that's where I'm going.
I understand, yeah, okay, but what I'm saying is that if you pay for these things now, you can take it to 8.3 maybe in a leap. Now, I don't know that that's possible. I can't predict the future any more than you can predict the bond rates. But you're probably right that if you went to a higher reserve, you might be looked at and shave a few points off of the situation. Not a lot, but, and I understand, I've heard talk that there is this idea that in a year or two you'll be in good shape for that kind of a program and you can float a lot of bonds to do the road work, particularly, of course, if the indexing goes. But again, that's a jump ball. I'm just saying that paying for things now is a good idea, as Lori said just a moment ago.
I'm not looking at issuing new bonds. I'm not looking at issuing new bonds. What I'm talking about is refinancing existing bonds.
I understand that. You've done a good job that down through the years, and your finance director has bought those in. I'm not arguing with you. I'm answering your question as best I know how.
You always have a good answer.
Well, I don't know if it's a good answer because, again, I can't predict the future. But bond rates are going to go up, as you and I probably know, although, again, we can't predict the future. So you're going to do it so fast. If you got to 8.3 and you could save that money next week or next month or next year, that'd be a good way to go. I'm just saying you got a really restless citizenry out here, and deservedly so. Our streets suck. I don't care what Patrick says. He says, they're in the middle. They're not in the middle. By his measurement, maybe they are. I don't know. I'm not questioning him. I think if he were smart, he'd be coming up here lobbying you harder and saying, they're terrible. We got to fix them. And I know he'd like to fix them. But your point is well taken. If you can save as much money through the bond rate, and you know the bond council that well, then I probably want to go invest through you, although I used to be an investment advisor myself.
I know you go see Warren Buffett all the time. Okay.
Any other questions?
No. Any further questions of John? Thanks for the intellectual debate here. Thank you. That's good. All right. All right. Any other public comment? Okay. Are we ready to talk about CIP? Then we'll see where the board goes.
Well, my thought on the CIP is that I'd like to see more go into the street maintenance fund. And so in terms of the fuel facility where the funds are not dedicated, and if we can save $280,000 and add to that the $150,000 that's allocated, that's another $430,000 that we can put towards streets. And I would prefer to see that, quite frankly.
Does that include the barn?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Any other comments or just discussion?
Yeah. I think that the Darren isn't going to hear this, but I think that the fuel facility is low-hanging fruit. Yeah. You know, there's $280,000. The truck barn. I'm kind of ambivalent on that, so you guys can decide on that. Let's see, the vehicle lifts were fine. Yeah, so those are the major items. You know, my personal preference would be to put off the second ambulance for another year or two because we just approved an ambulance. I don't believe it's been delivered yet. So we have another ambulance coming, and I always like to gap the replacement of assets. I think that helps us over the long term rather than getting two in the same year. If we got one now and we got one next year or the year after, I think over the long term that helps us. But I'll leave that for the rest of you to discuss. That's just my preference.
Go ahead, Lori.
How many ambulances do we have? I mean, I think it's difficult for me to know where we're going there because I don't even know how many we have. And I can't remember in our last meeting, is it a six-month lead time for order? And help me out there.
That is correct. We have three first out ambulances, probably the newer, the best of the three, and then three and that are in reserve, one of them which is heading out for refurb.
Six months by the time you get it fixed and back or whatever? Is it a...
From order of chassis to completion of project, you're looking at about 6 to 7 months. We have a 120-day build time from when the vendor receives the chassis from the manufacturer.
Okay.
So what's the average lifespan of the ambulance. So in other words, if we did one ambulance a year and we have three primary and three secondary, is that reasonable that we could do one ambulance a year and be refurbing one every year, and then we would constantly have a workable system?
Yes, once we get back on track. We're a little bit behind on replacing our ambulances at this point, as going into our first refurb, and is that we're 6 or 7 months out from the first refurb. By the time we put out a second request for proposal to get another ambulance, we could already be a year out by the time that is completed. We order a chassis, so you would still be staggering these almost a year apart. And that this ambulance is considered for refurbishment because it is one of my worst offenders in my shop. Compared to a newer component, it's costing almost 200% more in parts and labor to keep it on the road. I see it consistently in my shop about every month and a half.
Right, and my major concern is that we do start staggering these so that we get back into a workable system. So if, you know, if you're telling me that if we approve this appropriation now, that that is going to create a year gap between the one that we already approved and this one, then that meets my concerns.
Okay.
And Zach, could you, we talked briefly out in the hall about the fuel tank. Could you elaborate a little bit more on how much money that may save the city?
In a fleet perspective on the fuel facility, just efficiency and ergonomics. So instead of vehicles traveling out to satellite fuel stations and getting their fuel, they'll be getting their fuel right out the gate in the yard and they can leave and go to work. So that will even negate cents on the gallon where they would be traveling just to the fuel station to go get their fuel, on top of the fact that I'll be saving money on surcharge and delivery charge on my fuel per gallon.
On that basis of per gallon savings, do you have an idea of what you'd save in 1 year?
Like I spoke about before, that just on the surcharge and the delivery charge, I'm looking at about 8 to 10 cents a gallon, and I'm usually averaging between 8,000, about 8 to 10,000 gallons a month. So you could have anywhere between $800 to $1,000 savings per month just on fuel, just from having bulk fuel delivered to the yard.
Never far away.
I do, but
you kind of did.
Yeah. I won't hold you to the answer.
Yeah,
I think
no,
you know
it's
where I'm going.
You're absolutely right. We've never had it here at the city, and so does it need to happen this year? No, it doesn't. But it needs to. We cannot continue. I don't believe we need. We can continue to delay it. But I understand that there's a lot of concerns about the condition of our streets, and to put that money to streets. I really do understand that. The chief pulled me aside at the break and came from Florida, and he said right after the two hurricanes, every agency that didn't have them were building on-site fuel facilities because they ran into problems when the natural disaster struck. The fire that's up in Canada right now, agencies are trying to get fuel trucks to come and park in their corporate yards so they can use the fuel out of it. So it's just a risk that we're pushing down the road, but there's no reason it has to happen this year.
I think you've said it properly in the terms of risk, I think. Okay. Thank you very much, and thanks for your honest answer there. Not that you wouldn't give me a dishonest, you'd give me a dishonest answer, but it's a good answer. Thank you. Okay. Comment.
Hey, Darren, I got 30,000 gallons worth of fuel tanks. I'd be happy to dedicate them to you for your primary use.
And could we not also use DOT has fuel station here in Carson, and can you not, as a governmental entity, use their card lock at that fueling station? Right,
yes,
at the DOT yard?
We currently do use a state card lock system as well, so
right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's try a motion and see where we go. We can put that up for discussion. Don't somebody want to try a motion? Go ahead, Supervisor Adcock. Go ahead and discuss it and see if it gets a second, or we'll go.
On the direction to staff with regards to the capital improvement program, I'd like to see the funds that are not dedicated to the fuel facility, that aren't dedicated funds, to be applied to streets along with the truck barn. Otherwise, I agree with the capital city improvement program for fiscal years 2017 through 2021, and direct staff to return to the board with the final budget incorporating the approved capital improvement program for adoption at the public hearing scheduled on May 19th of 2016.
There's a motion and a second. On the motion, discussion?
Yes.
Discussion's in order.
And so I just want to be clear, then you're talking about $280,000 in funds that have been proposed for the fuel facility and $150,000 in funds that are proposed to be appropriated for the truck barn?
I am.
So $430,000.
Correct. Dedicated to streets maintenance.
So I believe there's only $50,000 in the street maintenance fund for the fuel facility, and the other funds are sewer, water, and.
Well, the motion was what comes out of it. I mean, you can't take, we're not going to take it out of there.
Yeah. It's $200,000 in the street maintenance fund. Mm-hmm. Because the truck barn and the fuel facility are 50. So there's $200,000 in the street maintenance fund that will go to road work instead of truck barn and fuel facility.
Correct. $200,000.
Mm-hmm. Right. And the balance is just undesignated.
Undesignated.
Further discussion?
Yes. One other point to discuss. One of my highest priorities is getting, whether you want to call it the ending fund balance, I prefer to call it the beginning fund balance, up to the 8.33%. And I don't see that that's feasible this year, but I would like us to consider bringing it, the fiscal policy back in front of the board as soon as possible so that we can amend that. And I would like that change to reflect a beginning fund balance of 8.33% beginning in fiscal year 2018.
And I agree with what Brad's saying there, and I think we might be able to accomplish that when it's time for augmentation, that would be your opportunity to accomplish that.
Yeah, as Nancy said earlier, our actual numbers have always come in over 8.3%. So.
Right. What I'm talking about is changing the policy.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. Right.
Yeah, well, that would be a separate
new agenda item.
Right. Yeah. Well, I tend to agree with that. It comes under agenda item too. I mean, Mr. Barrett and I had an intellectual discussion about that. But as I read some of the risk, you know, the credit rating reports. Moving back up to around 8 is going to get us back. You know, we lost a tick. We're still at 8, AA minus, but we could go back to AA, I think. I think those are correct things. You know, we could get back there, and I personally think that, one, it's the right thing to do for, you know, in case there's something goes wrong. And second, I think it gives us greater financing capability for not necessarily issuing new bonds, but refinancing existing bonds in terms of a lower rate. But City Manager, I'm sorry, did I step on your communication there?
No, Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to point out, when you get to item 26, Charlie, the next one I think you'll be able, if that is the direct, I don't think you need a separate agenda item.
Right.
I think if you want to.
We'll do it under 26, Charlie.
If you want to discuss it and give guidance and change the policy, I think you could do it under that agenda item.
I agree with that.
I'm not saying whether I agree with it or not. I'm just pointing that out.
I'd be happy to bring it up.
26 Charlie, man. Sounds like old days. Okay. All right.
Nancy, I just want to clarify the money again. On the fuel facility, there's $160,000. Is that correct?
Across all the different funds?
It's more than that.
Yeah, it's 280. Yeah.
280,000.
Sorry.
Across all of them. That's a total. Okay.
Okay. So.
So I believe we're just taking the 50,000 from the street maintenance fund and using that towards street maintenance. And then where it's budgeted in the other funds, we were just going to put it into undesignated. Yeah. And the transit fund, I'm not sure what they'll do with that because that they have to abide by the grant provisions for the transit.
50,000 from street maintenance and putting it to street repair.
Yes, this well, right. The street maintenance fund.
Right. And then the barn was 150,000, correct?
Yes, so 200,000 total to street repair and maintenance.
And the ending fund balance still comes out at 7.2?
About 7.04.
Okay. All right. Anything further? Any other discussion?
Yeah, just one final note, then. You don't have to augment the fleet fund in that case because we didn't approve the 60,000. So you don't have to worry
That's
about
correct.
That.
That's correct.
Okay. All right. I want to say this is a good job for the board, from the board and from staff putting this together. I mean, these are not easy decisions on, you know, because each decision, I think Mr. Schultz said it right, each decision comes with a risk. And you kind of have to, I don't think any of us up here have Solomon's wisdom. But this board and I think our staff has given us some good direction on it, so I'm prepared to vote for this motion. All right. On the motion, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Thanks. Okay. All right. Let's move to 26 Charlie. Charlie Mike, you know what that means? You do, don't you? I bet you do. Okay.
All right, so the Carson City Fiscal 2017 budget presentation was presented to the board on April 7th. Staff described the assumptions used to build the tentative budget and the outlook for the future. The 2017 tentative budget was filed with the Department of Taxation on April 15th. And this agenda item is to continue the review of the proposed 2017 Carson City budget and to discuss possible funding for staff recommended supplemental requests. So I'm just going to go into the supplemental requests. In March of 2016, departments presented their supplemental requests to the Internal Finance Committee. The total requests were $819,000, and the following on the slide are being recommended for funding by the Internal Finance Committee. So the first item is one FTE for an alternative sentencing officer for $82,000. From community development.
Questions as we go,
Let's
Mr.
Go.
Mayor? Sure. On the alternative sentencing, the $82,000, That's for the one FTE. Does it include the additional money for the drug testing that was requested?
No, it does not.
So it's just, okay. Why aren't we doing the drug testing if you're, I guess I'm not understanding why we're not putting in the money needed to do the drug testing. It was an $8,000 line item request for drug testing, and so I thought when we had the presentation March-ish, I thought we had a need to have more drug testing supplies, so I'm just wondering why we didn't do the $8,000 needed for the program.
Well, hey, Ted, come on up here. I'll have the chief address it, but as the IFC looked through it, if the Department of Alternative Sentencing, if he burns through his budget on drug testing, it's something we'll look at to augment. It's not like we're not going to do the drug testing. What I'd like to do is be able, not only for the chief here, but for all the department directors, to the extent that they can find savings within their own department budgets instead of coming for either a supplemental request or augmentation, that's my desire. He may very likely burn through it, and we'll have to look at it under augmentation.
Maybe he can just answer, because I thought it was that you already know you have a drug testing supply issue versus you might not have as many tests. So if you can clarify, because I can go either way depending on your answer.
All right. Currently, we have 32,000 on our line item. And from previous years, we constantly go up in the amount of drug testing that we're doing. It is hard to project. However, we have been trying to take measures to lower our costs. And it's hard to project the future. We could need the 8,000. We could need 10,000. We could need 5,000. We could break even. It's hard to tell.
Go with what the city manager recommends. Yeah.
So the next item is from community development to increase an hourly line item to pay for a special project planner part-time. The court clerk had $3,000 for codification, mileage $300, and two increases to two different hourly line items for rate increases for hourly employees. The public guardian is a change from an hourly employee to one FTE accounting clerk. IT is for software maintenance due to the contracts typically increase 5% per year. The library is for books and periodicals, $20,000. Some of these were being funded out of the Redevelopment Authority, and I know they're probably better fit in the general fund. The sheriff requested $8,925 for active strategy. And they would like to reclass a deputy to a sergeant. And they have already been budgeted. The acting pay for the deputy performing these duties has already been budgeted. So that's no additional cost for fiscal 17. And then the fire is an increase to an hourly line item to give rate increases. And the fire prevention dump trailer program, the grant funding is no longer available for that program. And then the transfer of 0.1 FTE from the grant fund to the general fund, that was previously funded by a public health preparedness grant, and that funding is also going away for that 10%.
Nancy, can you tell me what the increased hourly line item is in the fire department?
That is for a clerical employee, and I believe it's just to increase the pay rate due to taking on additional duties.
That is correct. We have one employee is hourly, and she's been taking on more of the duties with the staff that we have currently. And you know, she's that first person you see when you walk into the fire department. She's the welcoming committee, you should say. She's done a great job. She's fit in well, been part of our family. But the other thing, I'm speaking personally for myself, she's probably works with me the closest. and she's helped me with a lot of my community programs that we put on. And when when she came on, I said, hey, I need you. We put on a lot of community programs. You'll be my partner in some of these and help me coordinate these. And she said, negative, I'd rather just take them on myself. And she has. I mean, it went from something I need to monitor to something I do not need to follow up on. So she does the trailer and dumpster program, the community CPR, first aid, and all the other programs we do. She does the tracking. She does the cards. She does the inventory. She takes care of my invoices. She's kind of like my right-hand person. And so there's not much else I could do for her except offer that opportunity to give her a little bit bump in her raise for all of what she does for us and for me, and that's much I can do to say thank you. So that's, yeah.
Since you're here, can I ask you a question on the wildlife, the trailer program? So in the grant, it was restricted to the areas in which the trailer program could be utilized. So right. Now that it would become a general fund activity, it could expand to anywhere in the city. That met the needs of what you're trying to accomplish. Is that correct?
That is correct. I break the rules because there are people who really needed it, yes, within the town. Mm-hmm. And I had to stick by the rules and said rules are rules. And I like the fact that it could be open now, have a little more freedom. Just because you don't live in the WUI doesn't mean you don't have the weeds and tree problems. And mm-hmm. I welcome the fact that I'm hoping I get to do that.
Thank you.
Just because you live in the what?
The WUIs.
The WUI, okay. Yeah. All right. Wildlands. Is that a fire term?
You know, like the military, we have many terms, acronyms in it. It's Wild Urban Interface.
Oh, good. Okay. Thank you. All right. Thanks, Tom. All right. Further questions? Public comment on this issue? Board, we ready? Motions. Supervisor Bagwell, motions in order.
Okay. Actually, no direction. Just bring it back. Yeah. Move to bring this back for the final hearing on May 19th, 2016, as presented by staff.
Second.
Is that with an adoption of the
No.
budget?
Yeah, at the public hearing on the 19th.
So we're going to direct them. So the motion is to direct staff to return.
Can you amend that to include my previously stated goal?
Oh, we wanted to put it on 26C. And including the goal to get the beginning fund balance in 2018 to 8.3%.
Fascinating. Okay. All right. On a motion. Discussion? Is there a second?
I continue my second.
Okay. Further discussion on the motion? I had public comment already. Did you miss?
I must have missed it. Sorry.
Come on up. We have a motion on the table, so come on up. Now you can
talk
to the motion.
I apologize. I think I had to go see a man about a dog. And I have a dog who's waiting at home for me. You shredded my suggestion on the reserve ending fund balance, and if you can get to it as fast as you may be able to get to it, it may save you some money, but you really do have to get to it fast because bond rates are probably going to go up, but nobody knows the future. I already said that. However, you are very good at diverting me from the other part of my discussion, which is passing a resolution at some point, and I'm just suggesting it. I don't know that it's at this point. You'd probably have to put it on the agenda to commit at least some or all of the excess sales tax over and above the amount to deferred maintenance in streets. I'm primarily concerned about streets, but there's obviously a lot out there in other realms too. From what Supervisor Bonkowski said, I got the feeling that he wants to use that money to get there faster, or some of that money to get there faster. And I recognize that that's not a bad idea if you can get there faster. But still, there may be excess. I think we were told by the finance people, you're always coming in above 8.3. So I just leave that with you, and you can discuss it or dismiss it the way you dismissed the reserve ending fund balance.
Well, I think you misread what we did on the ending fund balance. You said you shredded it. I think we kind of split the baby.
Okay, I'll take that, Solomon.
All right. That's what I read out of that anyway.
Any questions?
I had that in mind when I voted for it. Let's put it that way.
Good.
All right.
All right. Any other discussion? This is on public. We had a motion in front of us here. Huh? Discussion's in order.
Yeah. And previously I said that my goal was to change the fiscal policy, and this motion does not do that. So if we're going to approve this motion, then I would still request that we bring back an agenda item rather quickly in the next couple of meetings so that we can discuss changing the fiscal policy.
Part of that, but we're probably cleaner to have the motion on the budget, mm-hmm. and then with the instructions that you know that you want the board. I think my sense is the board would like to see that. So, okay. All right. So the motion then is to direct staff to return to the board with the final budget for adoption at the public hearing scheduled May 19th. Is that right?
With an 8.3% model for the future. Yeah. That you wanted for right. The beginning fund balance.
We okay on that motion? Mm-hmm. Everybody understand it? Okay. On the motion, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Okay. All right. So we have a budget and we have that done. All right. Thanks to the public for bearing with us and providing valuable insight. All right. We're now going to take 25. Up non-action items by the board, so we're on item 25. Board members, any non-action items? Anybody, Jim?
Just real quick, I know Lori asked last week about the RV parking ordinance, where we're at. If it's possible when one board
member... hang on a second, folks. Let's go outside with the conversations if you can. I know it's late in the day, but hang on. I got a board member talking here, so... Okay,
I was just going to ask when discussion is in the progress and a board member asks a question for an answer to give to them, if it could get back to all board members. I don't know necessarily if we have to say, can all board members get the answer? Can we all be, you know, be informed? But, and I'm not picking on anybody. I'm just saying, but when the RV discussion was about where that ordinance is, it should come to all board members where we're at with that. If that's possible, that'd be great. That's all I'm asking for. And I will remind everybody, we are looking, I believe we're going to meet with the city manager over an agenda item over the streets. So thank you.
So I would just like to ask staff in the future, whenever we're bringing any contracts or anything that have references to plans or other projects or items, and we keep having blanks in which the date to that item is not listed in the contract resolutions, things like that. I'd like to see that changed to actually reference and provide the documentation so that when we're voting, we have a full understanding of what we're voting on. So thank you.
Let me just say, in commenting here, hats off and kudos to the sheriffs and our first responders for putting together a wonderful program for Deputy Carl Howell and our fallen officers. In spite of all the rain, it was a very moving experience and showed Carson City's heart, and it showed what we can do in spite of adversity. So, all right, are we ready for final public comment? Anybody? I don't see any then, so we'll close out final public comment. We'll adjourn. Unless there's an objection, we will adjourn. As the Board of Supervisors, I'll turn the gavel over to the President of the Redevelopment Authority.
I'd like to call to order the Redevelopment Authority and let the record reflect that we have a quorum, and move to item number 30, public comment. Is there any public comment? I guess not. Seeing none, moving on to item number 31, possible action, the approval of the minutes for April 7th, 2016.
I move to approve the minutes of the Carson City Redevelopment Authority for April 7th, 2016 as presented.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, motion passes. On to item number 32A. Nancy, will you take us through this?
Nancy Paulson, Chief Financial Officer. And this is the annual update of the Redevelopment Authority's Capital Improvement Program, which accompanies the annual budget. There's just a few items in this Capital Improvement Program, and for fiscal 17, we have $225,000 that is budgeted in undesignated capital infrastructure projects. And for fiscal 18, we have $200,000 for the east-west downtown street improvements and $101,000 for William Street Corridor Project. And then on to fiscal 19 is another $100,000 for the east-west downtown street improvements and $264,000 for the William Street Corridor Project. And then in fiscal 20, $200,000 for the east-west downtown street improvements. And these items were already brought to the and approved by the Redevelopment Authority on March 3rd.
I have a question for you, Lee. While you're walking up, if we heard earlier testimony that we may need to flip the order of the corridor improvement projects and do South Carson prior to William Street, if that's the case, then would you bring the approval of the William Street Corridor project back to the Redevelopment Agency and the board to reallocate that, or would you just roll it forward into future years for East William Street?
Thank you. Lee Plamel, Community Development Director. So you'll recall we went through the exercise of looking out with the budget and came up with those placeholders for those based on what we knew at the time for the project schedule. But the plan is to annually bring that through the RAC and Redevelopment Authority. So while those aren't expenditures this year, so next year and as we get, around this time this next year, as we get closer to knowing those times, we'll relook at that spreadsheet and see which projects need to have the funding first and decide if you want to even put that funding into those projects. So, yeah.
Any other discussion on or questions? Public comment? Seeing none, I'm going to bring it back to the board.
I move to accept the Carson City Redevelopment Authority Capital Improvement Program for fiscal years 2017 through 2021.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. On to item number 33, one more final public comment. Then I guess I get the last word.
Move to adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.